that he speaks to us. We need him. We need him so desperately in everything that there is. And the funny thing is, he's available. He's available, you know. He is so close that it is amazing how close he is. But we don't tap into that resource of him as we should. We don't call him as we should. He can lead us through the jungle. It seems like we have a personal machete and we want to track our way through the jungle. And Lord, are you there? Yeah, and he's on a path about 2 foot over here, you know. Yeah, I'm here. You want to join me? Oh, I got to get through this jungle, you know, and you're hacking away. And Lord, are you there? And he's, yeah, I'm over here about 4 foot. Yeah, you need to turn to the right a little bit. If we would just follow him, see, there's a pathway. We don't have to get out our machete and we don't have to do it the hard way. He is gracious to enable us to follow him if we will just keep that in our minds and in our hearts, that he is our great king. He's the lover of our life. He wants to bring us into a place that is filled with joy and filled with his leadership, which means we kind of trust him. Now, I saw some little kids earlier in the back there, and do you think they're wondering, well, Mommy, are you really going to have some lunch for us later on? You think they're wondering that? Do you think, well, is it really going to be a bed for us to get home when we go home for I can take a nap? Will I really have a room? They just simplicity trust. That thought is not even in their mind and in their heart. And your God, too, has made provision in his house for you amazingly, amazingly. And he cares so much to lead you into that lifestyle with him. So we pray and bless the word. Lord, I need your help to express your heart and your mind to us, your little ones. We give you invitation to come and stand in our midst and move all around us and breathe upon us. Breathe upon us fresh with your spirit to rejuvenate the spirit that you placed within us. For you are our blessed God. Come and open our ears to be able to hear and receive and transform us. And bring your great joy, the oil of your joy, and pour it over each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I would like to talk to you about, I feel a shift about God's divine purposes for you. There's a passage of scripture in the Old Testament that talks about And God made us out of dirt or out of the molecules of the earth, and that we would return to that dust. There's another passage in it that says ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And then after that, it also makes the statement that the body would return to the earth from that which it was formed out of, but the breath of God, his spirit, will return to him. Do you realize that your spirit was initialized by his spirit and is supposed to become his spirit because it will return to him? And if it's not his spirit when it arrives, if it was your spirit that you lived your life out in instead of his spirit returning to him, what the live part of you is going to return to him. And it's going to give a report as a spiritual being of what it accomplished for him. And did it become that which he designed it to become? Now, we know about the great white throne of judgment. I'm coming at this a little bit different so that you can recognize the breath of God is what is life in you. There is no electronic relays working without his breath. Now, Jesus came on the scene and said that he now was life, that the life was in him. So the breath that God put in us, guess whose breath that was, if he is life? It was Jesus' breath all the way back there when he made and started this thing. If it's Jesus' breath, then there's already a deposit in every man on the earth That's why there's a judgment. If there wasn't a deposit of God that was going to come back to him, if that didn't exist, there would be no judgment. Instead, he's judging that which he made in perfectness. His breath is perfect. And he will be judging whether it accomplished his will here on earth. And how can we accomplish his will if we never find our purpose? I find it interesting that we're always looking for purpose. The young people in college and all that stuff, they get on the bandwagon for every upside down green thing in the world. And that's because people are pumping that into their heads rather than they're looking for purpose. Even the guys and ladies that paint their hair orange and wear the mohawks and all that stuff, they're making a statement. They're looking and saying, well, what is my purpose? Now, I want to look kind of at Moses for a moment. A very interesting guy. A very normal person that got placed in a position of being an Egyptian. He was raised as a prince of Egypt. He was a great general in Egypt. They think that he was in charge of many of the building projects. And as a great general, he went up to conquer the southern part of Egypt. And when he did, there was a huge city that was built there. The Nubians were there. They were an amazing race, the Nubians were. They were always involved. They were always part of Egypt, the Nubians. And so there were several crowns. He went up to conquer that and saw that, well, you know, we could destroy this beautiful city and this society and all this stuff. We have enough men, but what if they, in turn, just wanted to merge and become a part of us? And he ended up marrying the queen of that nation to merge the two nations under one. He had a destiny that he knew inside of wanting to do something. He was slow in speech. He stuttered, in other words, in his speech. Can you imagine that, having a conversation with Moses? Said, you know, and he throw the rod down. he argued with God. I'm not an eloquent speaker. I'm giving you a rendition of Moses that perhaps you haven't been seeing with your eyes, because we just think of him as God's mighty man. Well, he was, but that's because God put that in him and on him. Matter of fact, he himself changed his identity because something in him told him. Something in him was whispering through the canyons of his life and saying, you're part of the Hebrews. You're part of... And when he made that discovery, he stepped down from being a prince of Egypt. And now what rattled in his soul is, oh my goodness, my people, they're being oppressed, they're being crushed down. And he, instead of using his power and authority as a prince to bring some of the oppression off them, he had stepped out of that and he wanted to be their leader and protect them. He really wanted to protect them. And the Hebrew was really beaten by a rather high official of the Egyptian tribe, because they had foremans over people, and the foremans are the ones that did the beating. And Moses looked and then went over and killed the Egyptian and buried him in the sand. Now the Hebrews saw that. None of the Egyptians did, but some of the Hebrews were actually linked with Pharaoh. I don't know if you know that or not. Did you say the movie Moses? James Cagney played a great part in there, always being the obstinate one. If you haven't seen it, please do. Please do again, because it'll refresh your soul to the God's joyous leadership in our life. Anyway, getting back to the story. Moses is there, and the next day he finds there's a couple of Hebrews fighting. And no big deal about that, right? They fought him for 40 years in the desert. and he comes up and he, brother, yeah, y'all shouldn't be fighting your brothers. And their comment was, who made you judge over us? How would he know inside? And why would he want to judge those matters? And why would he want to protect that which was there, which was his race? My point is, there was something deposited within him that was his destiny and his role. There's something that stirred him that wanted to accomplish something, but he didn't have the ability or the skill nor the power to intervene. He didn't have the ability and skill and was not appointed as a judge. And the Hebrews just rejected him. But my whole point about telling you this story is there was a deposit in there of something calling to him. We too have a deposit of something calling to us. That is God. And is God calling us up into his presence? Now, after Moses killed the Pharaoh, he found out that news was going to be passed on to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh, sure enough, issued an arrest warrant for his death, and he fled the land, and he was 40 years old when he left, and he wandered around in the desert, ended up in Midian, sitting at a well, and he lived for the next 40 years, not knowing where he was going and what he was doing. He just cared for somebody else's sheep. It says that in Exodus chapter 3, now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. He hadn't even established a flock for himself. He's not trying to build anything. He's just stumbling around without an identity, without a purpose. For 40 years of not knowing who he was, of trying to fulfill something that was in him on his own, and he could not do it. He could not do it. Finally, an angel of the Lord set a bush on fire on the mountain, and Moses goes up and to see. He says in verse 3, and Moses said, "And now I will go up there and I will see what this great sight is, and why that bush is just not completely burned up by now." And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see him, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, "Moses, Moses." Now, where did Moses have to come from and where did he have to go to? He was down in a lower place and he had to go up to a higher place in order to have that encounter. God is always calling us to higher places, and part of the problem is that we have our lives built in a different place. Bring the lights down, please. And is the projector going? It is. Can you kill the lights? Now, what we have here is our lives. We live in a canyon of selfishness, a canyon that is, yeah, that's the water down below. There's no fields on the sides of that bank to be able to plow. I would say that there's layers going down. You see the different layers down here of sediment before you get to the bottom where the water is. It's almost impossible to climb out of the canyon. And why would you? Because God, in his mercy, in our life that is filled with sin and our own purposes, he sends the water of his word and the water of his presence and the presence of his spirit down into the bottom of where we live. And he begins to speak to us there. And he begins to refresh us with the water. He sends us. But that refreshing is not for us just to stay there. I'm reminded of Elijah when he sat down under a broom tree and complained to God, "Oh God, just kill me. Jezebel's going to try to kill me. I'm done for. Would you take me?" And God honored every word this man said. Do you realize that God came and took him? Because he requested, God came and took him. And he finally said, "Okay, I'll do that for you. I'll come get you. But between now and then, I want you to go down and anoint this guy king and this other guy over here general. And I want you to go down and find Elisha And I want you to anoint him to replace yourself. But before he told him that, he sent him on a little trip. It was a 40-day trip to Mount Horeb. Remember, Mount Horeb is where the Israelites went, where Moses went, where God met with him. And here Elijah is being called to that. And the angel twice shows up and gives him bread and water. And then finally, after giving him bread and water on the second time, he said, "Now, come on. Now, you've got to eat this because this is going to be a long journey on you." And he went for 40 days and 40 nights without water and without food, heading from Mount Horeb to have an encounter with a living God. And there he met the presence of God, Elijah did. And Elijah then received instructions of who to anoint and king. And so we have the meeting of Moses on Mount Horeb, and we have the meeting of Elijah on Mount Horeb. My point is God was calling them to a place to receive further instructions about what they were supposed to do in life. Now, we are in our canyon. You can see there's still no place to plow, no place to plant. This is the layers of the time zones of our hearts and of our lives and the things we've not done and the things we've not accomplished or the things we did do and didn't accomplish. And you can see we do get some flowers in our lives, in our canyons. There's deep canyons within us, and that's what God is calling us out of. He's calling us up to himself. He's calling us up to a higher place. And he wants us to get refreshed in the water of his word and the spirit. Elsewise, we cannot make the journey out of the canyon. But you cannot find your way out of this canyon unless you can follow his voice. You have to be able to hear him to follow his voice. Now, even before we develop ears to hear him, a deaf man, if God spoke, could hear him say, "Come to me, come to me." Now, the problem with canyons is if you're living down in them and you feel nice and safe and secure, keep in mind there's always going to be a flood. So even if you did plant on the banks, whatever you planted is going to be washed away. We cannot live our lives in ourselves and in our purposes for our own functionality. If we do, it becomes an endless maze, and we just travel like Moses did for 40 years, just wandering in the canyons of our lives, not knowing God, but yet getting to drink a little water. Now, I can tell you, I've been at the headwaters of the Colorado River, and that's back up in the mountains in Colorado, and man, is it beautiful. And man, is there lots of lakes up there, and boy, is there lots of snow in the wintertime. And it's a storehouse of, we used to go skiing up there, and it's a storehouse of the snow that provides water for, I'm going to say, a third of the United States that comes out of that river. And my point being is, why can't we have sense enough to try to seek God so that we can get out of the canyon? Now keep in mind, there's a vast desert once you do get out of the canyon, and God has put that vast desert there that, like he did before the Israelites, that they couldn't, they're losing their Egyptianism. Your Egyptianism is being lost if you're in the desert. But God's still calling you to himself, and he's calling you a certain way. This canyon has all kinds of things in it as far as water supply. Sometimes there's water coming straight out of the rocks. Sometimes it's nearly a mile deep. Sometimes there's waterfalls coming out that are crystal clear, that form beautiful pools in the bottom of Grand Canyon. Now, my point is that in the bottom layer of our life, we can get some comfortable zones. And because we have comfortable zones and a little drinking water and a little swimming hole, a little place to grow a garden, we don't go pursue him. And when he wants us to pursue him, he wants us to climb up to him, just like Moses. He saw the bush, and now he could either stay in the desert of his life without identity, or he could climb up to God. And when he meets God, then God begins to tell him who he will be. Now, Moses' first question was, "Who are you?" Now, see, we want to know a lot about God. And God wants us to know a lot about ourselves and Him. Why? Because it's His Spirit that He put within us. And He wants that Spirit to be connected to the Holy Spirit so that that Spirit, your thinking capabilities, becomes energized by the Holy Spirit, and now that thinking capability becomes activated from His presence to accomplish His purposes. Moses didn't get it. He said, "Who are you?" "What? Just say, I am." How does something that covers everything and that has made everything and is a part of everything describe Himself? It's I am is a pretty good name, right? In other words, I am everything that you stand on. I'm everything that you breathe. I'm everything that you eat. I am the time zone that you're in. I am the future that you're going to be in. I am the past of all humanity. I am everything that there is. There is nothing without me, and everything is in me. And Moses goes, "Okay, what does that mean?" That's kind of the way we are, but we keep picking at it and looking to see who He is when we should be looking to see who He wants us to be. God always switched the tables on him and said, Moses, now, here. You're going to be going and doing this thing for me. Oh, is there somebody else you can send? He said, I stutter a lot. Now, can you imagine God is peaceful enough and him waiting for Moses to get the words out? Maybe a half a day trying to say, can you send somebody else? And God's patiently waiting. And God has chosen his man. Now, at the same time, you may not know it, he also chose Aaron. Because Aaron has been, days before, he chose Aaron and gave Aaron an assignment. You come to this mountain, and you're going to meet your brother there. And God said, I'm going to make Moses a god to Aaron. And why? Because God wanted man to realize there's something in man that can do and fulfill God's will that's a part of God. When do you think he made the statement, I'm going to make you a god to Aaron? There was something significant about that, not about the man, but about God coming into Moses and activating the Spirit was within him, with his Spirit, to accomplish his works. Now, Moses, he was like us. God said, here's a rod. And Moses said, okay, that's great. And God says, now, I want to show you something that when you go there, you will have some power. Throw the rod down. And he throws the rod down, and it turns into this huge snake, and Moses takes off running. And I'm sure God said, wait, Moses, wait, come back here. Moses comes back and he tells him, now pick it up by the tail. He just ran from it. Now he's got to pick it up by the tail. He does, and of course it turns back into a rod. And he begins to learn that God has power. God has him stick his hand inside his coat, and he pulls it out, and it's white with leprosy. And can you imagine the panic stricken? I mean, if you had leprosy, you were dead. That means his fingers were rotted off, his hand was white. And can you imagine pulling that out and seeing that? And then God says, now, I know you're frightened to death. Stick it back in your coat. And he pulls it out and it's healed. Now, my whole point in telling you this, Moses was making discovery of the deposit that God was placing in him through the encounter. Now, he would have never made that discovery had he not come upon the mountain, came out of the canyons of his life. And our canyons can be quite pretty. Sometimes we don't want to leave them. Because, I pray and I drink the word and I come and sit on the pew. None of that is being in his presence. All of that is necessary for being in his presence. Do you understand the difference between the two? It's like saying I'm American, but I'm on vacation in Europe. I may be an American, but if you're standing on holy ground, see, now that's what Moses went up to. He went up to holy ground, and God told him, I've made this holy ground, and take your shoes off. So there's another place that we can meet him besides our ho-hum little humdrum lives, in faith, with spiritual eyes, and in a spiritual experience on a holy ground to see a living God. He has each one of us. He's called. He's called us out of the depths of our lives. And I liken this picture to us down here. We're still beating the different pathways and looking through the canyons of our life. But we may have climbed up something and had some experience with God, and it was a mountaintop experience. But it's not connected to anything else. It's just a single experience that you end up either having to climb back down because you can't go on, or you stay there and starve and you need water. And you know, instead of following his voice said, "Oh, come up here." And we traveling along with him. "Oh, well, there's a big thing," and we climb that. Well, no, he means come to me. Come to me. He has a specific pathway out of the canyons of our lives. Now, there is a pathway that goes down into Grand Canyon that little burros and donkeys and mules and stuff take millions of people down there every year to see that canyon. And it's a pathway. It just hangs right on the edge of the canyon. And with God, there is only His pathway will lead us out with the sustenance that we need. Now, here's the problem. Down in the canyon, we have our place of safety, and that's even down a little bit further. And we think, oh, this is a nice, safe place. It's pretty. It does neat things with light when the sun shines out there. And, oh, I love the shapes. Now, there's things about our lives and lifestyle that we do like. And God is saying, I understand that you like that part of your lifestyle. I understand that you think you're safe. But let me ask you a question. If a flood comes, what's going to happen to your little tunnels? How do you think they got created? They're going to be full of water. So it's God's engineered design to show us a way out. He's saying, come to me. Come to me and know me. Come to me and hear my voice. Listen to my voice. Now, his voice, would his voice echo through this place? It would. So you're going to have to get everything still around you so that you can hear where the first voice comes from. And then also hear where the last echo comes from. Do you know why? Did y'all ever see Journey to the Center of the Earth? They were looking for somebody. The first voice was its origin. It would bounce all the way through, but it also would bounce all the way back. And so the first and the last little peeps that you heard was where the origin was of the voice, instead of it being over there or over there. There's many things in the canyons of our life, because they're so full of our own attributes, our own purposes, and they're large. Our canyons are very large. As a matter of fact, when we come out of our little hidey holes, like that little place of safety, oh, well, this is beautiful. I think I'll camp out here. But this is still down in the canyons. It's still down in places like this. And this thing goes for 1,000 miles. This is no small thing. And your life is not a small thing. Your life, if you get into the Colorado River, you can travel all the way to Mexico from Colorado. But that's not your destination. Your destination is to come out, while you're up in the high country, to come out of that canyon, which is going to take some climbing, which is going to take some climbing gear. Now, there's three things that you're going to need in order to establish God's divine purposes in your life and get your new identity. The first thing is to hear His call. And you're going to have to still yourself to be able to do that. Most of us still ourselves in front of the boob tube or in front of playing games or doing something. We have our certain ways that we want to spend our downtime. Granted, we're creatures of adventure. We need some of that downtime. But God is saying, will you also pursue me? Because there's many times that we're just bored to death, and so we try to take it as downtime rather than seeking Him, the one who can give us all adventure. So if His voice is echoing, why don't we stop making noise and listen for His voice? Just take time to listen for His voice. Now, when you do hear it, what He's going to say is, come to me. And what He's going to say is very personal, Because what was the first word he said to Moses? He said it twice. Moses. Oh, Moses. He said his name. God will say your name if you will listen. He will call you by name. Jesus said, I know my sheep. He calls us by name. Now, when he calls us, it's to a certain pathway. It's not the complete destination. He can call, and I go to that point, to where I hear his voice. I stay there until I hear him call again, and then I go to the next point. Because there will be sustenance, food, and water at each one of the points that he calls us to. Because if we're leaving the base of the canyon, where the water from heaven keeps going downward, it wants to make sure to energize and anyone that will listen down in the dregs of our life. He will make sustenance as we're coming out, and he will lead us all the way out and up. Now, that's designed for a purpose, is that we can have to make a decision. Do I want to respond to the call? Nearly every day I get up, do I want to respond to the call? If I'm willing to respond to the call and waiting, I'll hear him. Now, does he know that I have things to do? This is God we're talking about, and of course he does. Does he know that I choose many things to do that I didn't have to do? Now, there's part of the big problem, right? And we need to put an X on those things and put God in first place. Now, the enemy lies to us and tells us, now, if you get out of that canyon, it's just going to be colder than you can imagine up there. There's nothing up there. Look, it's just in the cloud. Nothing's going to grow up there. It's all frozen. He lies to us about what it would be like to be in God's presence. He is the liar. God is not. He is the liar. This is always his description, that there won't be anything there if I pursue God. And then he shows us, now look, how great this kingdom is I gave you. And if you look real close, it looks like desert to me. Oh yeah, I can give you a new high religious experience. He wants you out here rather than finally getting out of the canyon where you can walk to the mountains. I can even give you a double high point right there in the middle of your canyon. You know, come on, I'll give you a new church high. We'll give you a new spiritual high. Our hearts are supposed to go from one experience to the next experience. The scripture calls it us going from glory to glory. Glory means God revealing himself. We're supposed to be going from glory to glory to glory. Now, Satan wants us to be individualized, where we're just this little mountain ourselves, and God, I'll just meet with you in this spot. I never get out of the canyon. My life is still here. My sustenance still has to come from my life. God has something different in mind, and you can see, I don't know if you've ever been to Arizona. I have. I was raised in the desert, and I understand the desert and desert life, and how joyous it is to find a little water down in the bottom of the canyon. I can remember about two-thirds of my life, or half of my life, I yearned for the mountains. And it seems like my dad always lived in the desert. And when we found water, it was something. It was something to discover water. But inside, there was something in me that just, I long for the mountains. I long for snow. I long for big trees and lush grass and to hear the wind blow through the pines. And I love mountains. I don't know why, I just do. And God is calling us out of this, which is our endless canyon of our life that just continues on down into the pit. And we can color it with whatever we want. But this is a description of my life and your life, and it's a description of what God is saying. Come out of there. I've got something different for you. Now, the moment Moses had the encounter, his life changed, did it not? he was sent down back into the canyon. Hey, go get the rest of the natives too. But where was he to bring them? Back up even to a higher mountain, right? And then into a place that God had specially designed for them. Now, I want you to know, as you climb out of Grand Canyon, there are all kinds of little trails, that water comes popping out of the sides of the walls, and everything is green right there along that little stream. Jackie spent an entire week climbing down Grand Canyon on the south side and going up the north side and up Bridal Veil Trail, I believe, which is miles of traversing. Took a week to make this hike. And then come back across Grand Canyon. And she told me, she said, you know, whenever we get hot, we just take off our packs and just jump in the pools of water. Then they get out and it's so cold because of the aridness of the air that's there. And now I ask you, would you rather live down in where the desert is? Or would you rather to answer call of God and begin to seek Him and pursue Him? There's something different that we can establish in our relationship with Him that will bring our spiritual life into reality of where we are. When I say a spiritual life, God's presence, His throne, His kingdom, His holy mountain really exist. His cities exist. Abraham would not settle because he had seen the heavenly city. And because he had seen the heavenly city and possibly even visited there, he would not even build anything on the face of this earth. And he came from one of the most dramatically beautiful cities in the world, down in the Babylonian area. He came from a place that was well watered in the desert. But God is calling us to a different place, and that place is in Him, high, high up in His presence. To where we can be delivered from all the habits, we can be delivered from the structures, we can be delivered from the demands, we can be delivered. Instead, now, do you think that you can't live a life here? I could. Couldn't you build something here? Couldn't you actually build a life here? Couldn't you plant a garden here? Couldn't you build a house here? And my whole point that I'm trying to get through is that we spend so much effort to build our lives and this life that we miss the green pastures that God has for us in the upper elevations. We miss the ability. I don't know if you've ever been in a desert. You can't escape the heat. You know, I lived in the Mojave Desert one time, right at the edge of Death Valley, and I'm telling you can't escape the heat. They have some 130-degree temperatures there, and you cannot get out of the heat. They have winds so hard that blow in Death Valley. There's these lines that are going across the valley, and if you follow that line 30, 40, 50 miles, you know what you find? A stone. The wind's been blowing the stone across that valley for years, and it leaves marks right through the ground. Now, we can make our choice. If we say that our canyon is good enough for us, we will not climb up to pursue God. If we say that our canyon will provide all our needs and we've got some religious experiences going on, then we'll never find the purposes of God. In Proverbs 20 and 18, every purpose is established by counsel. Now, whose counsel do we need? We need God's counsel. My days are past. This is in Job 17:11. My days are past and my purposes are broken off, even my thoughts in my heart. Remember Job, he had his life built. And now, he's climbing up out of the canyon of all the events of his life. And he makes this statement, my days are past and my purposes are broken off. We need our purposes broken off for our life. And we need to get the days that we live for ourselves behind us, because the spirit that God deposited in you is going to return to Him. And what did it accomplish while it was here? It's going to be giving a report of what it accomplished for Him. Now, I would suggest to you that you can't accomplish what He has for you unless you hear His plans for you. Because when He begins to establish through teaching you, now, we have to put on the equipment, too, of getting there. I'm assuming you have some of the skills and the abilities and been developing those for scaling the walls of this canyon of our lives. In order to hear, we must assume and understand that we must be willing to repent. That's a simple thing. These are some of the simple things that you need as equipment to get out of the canyon. Repentance. Also, we must receive Jesus. You can't go up these walls without Him and His leadership. We also must be filled with the Spirit. Have you been filled with the Holy Spirit yet? If you haven't, that doesn't mean you can't get right up to the bottom of the canyon. It doesn't mean Jesus can't lead you up some of the less steep slopes. But there will come a time that you would need the infilling of the Holy Spirit. So there's things that we're supposed to acquire for this journey. We're supposed to be filled with the Holy Spirit and with the foundation of the apostles' doctrine. Those are the ropes that we'll use to hang on when we get onto some of the sheer cliffs. And those are some of the clips that you'll drive into the canyon walls in order to make your ascent out of this place. Now, keep in mind, you can just stay in the canyon and end up in Mexico. And you can try to climb out there, and you're still in the desert. God is at the headwaters of all of this. And we need, and I understand that the canyons are deep in that area, we need to climb out there and then traverse the mountains to come to Him. Now, He's not called us to anything we're not capable of doing if He empowers us. It's impossible to do this if we're running under our own power, and it's more impossible to do it if we don't want to climb out of the canyon of my life. I just want to be secure. God, You come and bless my mess. Most prayers in Christianity are around, come and bless my mess. And He's willing to come down and bless it so that we can get rejuvenated and restored, and He's willing to establish Himself, that He's real in our presence. He's willing to stay in our canyon with us for a long season, but it's for the empowerment of teaching us how to come to Him and how to come into His fellowship and how to know Him. Now, I also must point out that you're going to need the cleats to drive in the wall. That's the Word of God. We stand on the Word. We hang on every word that He speaks. And I don't know if you know what a cleat is. That's what you're going to drive in and snap your rope to. We're also going to need the ability to be able to hear the Holy Spirit. That takes a helmet of salvation to go over our ears. And we also need everything that we're going to be doing established by two or three witnesses. That means we're supposed to be a family of God together, because we can't repel alone. It's absolutely suicide to try to climb a canyon wall alone. We were supposed to do this together with a leader, and Jesus is our leader, but we're supposed to do this together. So we need two or three witnesses. Now, in John 10:24, He said, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me." So what is the purpose of our climbing together? It's that we might, one, learn His voice, and two, know Him. You remember, and Him know us. You remember the qualification for entering the gate at the end of all this? Is whether Jesus makes the statement, "I know you, come in." So on the canyon walls are not superfluous, and the canyon is not superfluous. That's where we get to know Jesus, because we will need Him to face the perils, to get out of our mundaneness and out of our physical environment into a spiritual environment. Now, keep in mind, on top of the canyon, there's a plain that's a new spiritual environment. It's purposely in the desert so that you don't seek water anywhere except Him. He becomes the spring of life, just like the Israelites, the Scripture says, and that rock followed them for 40 years. You know, that's the rock that the water came out of. The Scripture literally says in the New Testament that the rock followed them for 40 years. You ever wonder how they continue to get water? Can you imagine that? Waking up every morning and wow, that rock moved. And look, there's a stream running by here, you know. Everybody jumps in with their swimming suits and get their lawn chairs out, I'm sure. Now, in 2 Timothy 1:9, God who has saved us has called us with a holy calling, not according to our works. He saved us, and He called us with a holy calling. You know what a holy calling is? That means you set yourself aside. You separate yourself to seek Him. That's what the call is. He's saying, "Come up here, Elton." He said, your name, your command is to come up there, you're to traverse that particular point, because he made the statement to come up there. If you respond to that, he has separated you out to himself, and you will feel the separation. Do you know what it's like to have the layers of something that is not clean stripped off of you and now be clean? Do you know what it's like to go out and work in a dung heap and shoveling cow manure, and it's all over your clothes and everything, and you come in and you peel all that clothing off? That's what he's saying here when he makes the statement that there's a, I'm calling you. And when he calls us, it's to separate us from some of the filthy thoughts, actions, deeds, my way or the highway type attitudes. He wants to separate us from those and free us from those. And then he says that they will follow me. He goes on in this and he says, let me reread it. God, who has saved us and called us with the holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purposes. Now, my whole point, we started out in this, that you'll find your divine identity in him. But if we're going to do that, then our identity is in the purpose that he formed us and whether we listen to what he wants us to accomplish here. There's where I'll receive my identity, and there's where I'll receive the sustenance and strength to perform spiritual things here on earth for the living God in my duties. So I must insist that you understand everything that he's calling you to. If he's calling me up out of the canyon, it's for his purpose. If I come up out of the canyon and say, oh, I'm finally free from all that dirt. Now, oh boy, have I got some plans. We can build something here. And hey, let's go up to the mountain. We can build something there. You remember when the three apostles saw Moses and Elijah with Jesus? They wanted to build something there. What we're supposed to be asking is, Lord, what would you like done? You're standing here. And thank you for giving us this revelation of seeing these guys and them standing here. Now, God and his purposes for you are directly connected with you finding out what your identity is. Now remember, Moses was fulfilled when he accepted God's purposes and began to carry them out. The identity that God had for him began to be formed in him. The identity that God had for him could not be formed in him unless he had gone to do God's purposes. The two intertwined together so much. So if you want to make discovery, if you feel this call inside of, oh God, I want to do something for you. I want to do something. Well, if you do, then here's the trip that you need to make. And it's up into his presence. In Romans 8:28, for we know that all things work together for the good of them that love God and to them who are called according to his purposes. Now, where's God's good ready to be deposited? To those who are called according to his purposes. I'm trying to get something installed in your heart and your mind that there's something connected to his purposes that will benefit you, that will not only get you closer to him, but all the provisions that come, all the good that God has stored up for us can only be allocated to us from above. Is that right? The scripture says every good thing comes from above. Well, he's trying to get us up there where we can receive more of the goods that he had for us. But we can't do that unless he sees in our heart, what's your purpose of coming up here? What's your purpose of you wanting to know me? I mean, God didn't answer Moses' question too good. He basically just told him, you go and you tell them I am. Moses is wanting to question him, who are you? Would you explain some more? How did you get here? Were you born? Were you hatched? Where did you come from? Are you from another planet? Are you just like one of these other gods? Are you more stronger than Zeus? Are you more stronger? Let's talk about God. And God didn't have any conversation with him. He just called him up there, said, here's your purposes, you fulfill these, and his identity was established in the purposes of God. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image. Now, I love that passage of Scripture because if you get to know Him traversing the walls of getting out of our own will and our own way, the canyon of our own will and our own way, if you're willing to traverse that with Him, you'll get to know Him, which means He foreknows you. And that means He predestinated you to be conformed into the image of His Son. Do you have any problem with the image of His Son? I don't. It's delightful. I don't like my image, though. Now, I should be taking great faith and great confidence that He is doing something, and I should be trusting Him that since I'm willing to traverse the wall, I'm not out of it. I remember this layer. Boy, this layer was a bad... I'm talking about the layers in the canyon, you know. You get real close to those layers. The Lord might even look over as He's handing a repelling rope. And would you explain to me what this layer means? you know, that's when I was... can we go? Let's move on. Oh, my rope's slipping. You know, I go down three levels. I don't want to talk about that layer. And all He wants me to do is get above that layer, but realize how that layer got there so I don't try to relay that layer again in a later zone. So He says, for those He did foreknow, He did also predestinate to be totally conformed into the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn amongst many brethren. Moreover, whom He did predestinate, He also called. Where does the predestination take place? Out of our response to the call and us being willing to climb through the layers of our past to get above what we were to become something that we are not. He predestinated us. Moreover, whom He predestinated, them He called, and whom He called, them He also justified. You always wonder about, well, man, Lord, we're right here. I ask You for Your forgiveness. Big difference in being forgiven and it justified. Justified means it's taken away. Jesus, if you'll hang with Him there on those ropes and look into the sixth sin that you had that He's pointing at, if you won't try to get out of it and you allow Him to point at it, His final statement, looking you in the eye, laying His hands upon you, I took this. I became this. It's no longer a part of you. And how do I know that? Because He was the supreme sacrifice. How do I know He laid His hands upon us? Because there had to be a transfer from us to Him. Isn't that how the sacrifice was done? The sacrifice had come in and people laid their hands on it and sin was transferred. Jesus is willing to lay hands on you right in front of whatever that trespass is that you can't get out of your heart, out of your mind. The thing that you feel absolutely condemned for, He's willing to, if you'll stand here with me and look at this and really realize, let me lay my hands upon you and let me take it upon myself. If it's taken upon Himself, then justification comes and freedom comes. Our climb out of this canyon is no small thing. He has all kinds of plans to change our past and to bring us into the future of His justification. And then He makes a statement, whoever I justify, I also will glorify. Do you know what that means? Glorification is a spiritual term. It means that now the spiritual man gets to see the spiritual God. Because the only glorification that takes place is when God appears, right? And the glory of God, the doxa, that's the glory of God. When that appears, then there's something that takes place that the two beings can commune. Jesus is willing to do all these things for us as He brings us up out of this canyon, up to the mountain of God. And I love this picture. You know, that's not snow, that's solid marble. God is calling us to Himself. He's calling you and saying, I can deal with these things, but don't be so permanent in your canyon and don't be so distant you can't tell where my voice is coming from. His whole purpose is to lead us out. Now, does He have a life for us? Because Satan says, well, He's going to lead us out and we don't have a life. That's not true. his life is full of... Did Moses have a life after God called? He didn't have much of a life. He was a sheep herder. He sat around a well, and there were somebody else's sheep. He didn't have a life. For 40 years, he strayed. He didn't know what to do. And if you've been straying and you don't know what to do, and I'm not talking about sinning, it's just not knowing what to do. God's calling you. Your whole duty in this life is to come to Him and pursue Him. God is a gracious God, and He's saying, come up here, come up here. I can make a way for you. I can make a way for you to know me, and a way to walk with me, and a way to hear me. I can get you out of where you are and get you into something so revelatory that your heart will be absolutely thrilled with the experience. Experience means true exposure to something that you physically can reach out and touch and become a witness of, to where it becomes so much a part of this world that it becomes your chief pursuit. Remember, all the water that we saw in the bottom of the canyon comes from someplace, comes from one place. That's what we should be heading to the headwaters, because they're pure. If we can get to the headwaters and God sees us, it's your purpose to get to the headwaters, then every good thing is opened in God to us. So what is your purpose? If your purpose is, well, I got to manage this side of the canyon this week. You say, oh, well, I guess you didn't want the good things I had for you. Oh, wait, I do. You willing to leave that part of the canyon? Yes, I'll leave that part of the canyon. Now, he realizes there's crops that you've raised that you'll need to harvest. He realizes there's a planting time. He knows all that. But what's supposed to be deposited in your heart? The purpose of, I'm coming to you, O Lord, and I'm responding to you, and I'm waiting for your next call. If you had a cell phone, and I put you in a nice garden, and I said, would you wait for my call here? And you said, yes. And I come back in 2 years. During that time, you had something to eat. You had a pleasant time. God never deposits us in a place in our spiritual growth that we cannot have sustenance. He always manufactures, makes, and deposits the sustenance we need for the future. Now, we can be our own depositor if we want to, but those things, remember when they gathered manna for the extra day, what happened to it? It rotted. It was no good. So we must purpose in our heart, you are my only supply. You are the purpose that I'm here on earth. My spirit is going to come to you, and it's going to give a report of what it accomplished. The body will be dropped off, become a part of the earth again. But the spirit that belongs to you, the spirit belongs to him. Your spirit belongs to him. It will be returning. And oh, will it return in joy? If not, then it can. Will it return with its true identity formed in it? If not, it can be. God is calling you and wanting to anoint you into a new identity born in Him. Shall we pray? Lord, we declare our affection for you, our love for you. Our canyons are so big, we almost don't even see them as canyons. We call them canyon lands. So diverse, we just switch from one canyon to the next. But would you call us to yourself, Lord, to each and every person that says, Lord, I want a new purpose. I want your purposes. I was called to you, but for your purposes. Truly, you have it figured out of all that our children will need, our wives and our husbands. You have it figured out, all those things figured out. So help us be like little children that just will depend upon you and follow your voice into your holiness, into your righteousness, into your justification, into your glorification. How I praise you and thank you. Illuminate this to us that we might receive it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Anyone needs prayer, I'd be glad to pray for you.